This episode of Live WP TV is sponsored by...
So, my name is Greg Whitehead, and I've been a developer with PHP MySQL for about 10 years now. Did my first website almost 20 years ago, and been programming for almost 30 years now, and I've been doing it for fun, and, you know, something for me to do after school, and learned QBasic, and playing with gorillas on the computer. So, but, you know, over the last few years, I've noticed that a lot of people have been bad at updating their WordPress and keeping their site up to date with their plugins and everything. So every now and then, a client will call me and say, my site's not working, or it's down, or something about it is broken. So I got to find myself having to go in and figure out what's going on. So, you know, from this talk, you'll figure out what are some of the signs that your site's been hacked, you know, what kind of code to look for in some files, some of the commands that you can use to search within Linux to find what files have been modified, some useful plugins that'll help you in, you know, finding those files as well, how to restore your site, and then go through making sure that it's protected in the future. So one of the big signs that your site's been hacked is if you go to Google and you see that nice little blue thing that's underneath it that says, this site may harm your computer. Usually means there's a nice little JavaScript insert at the bottom of your site that redirects people to either an advertisement site or some place that is trying to have you install some malware. You know, or you're getting... Oh, go ahead. It could be because of the advertisements that you have on it. It might not be like a hacked site, but they see you know, JavaScript ads or redirections as possible hacks of a site. Yeah, just because it's basic, sometimes they'll flag that. But there's a way that in Webmaster Tools where you can go and you can, you know, ask Google to reconsider your site again. So, you know, there's ways you know, to try to stop that. So another thing that you can see as a sign that your site's been hacked is you're getting bounce back messages to your main mail account saying that this message is undeliverable. And of course, they're messages that never originated from your mail account or and stuff like that. It has, like, you know, content trying to sell prescription medicine that you are not trying to sell, kind of a thing. You might also get notices from your host that your site's been suspended for, you know, spamming out emails or having malware on the content of the site. I've received clients that have gotten notifications from financial institutions that there's been pages on their website that are asking people to enter in their account information. So, in other words, what hackers have done is they put in pages in subdirectories somewhere, sent out emails to a group of people, and are directing them to your site, and it's like a fake financial institution page. So they're trying to get that person's login information to then, you know, do some malicious stuff with it. So another thing is when you're browsing around your site, sometimes it'll redirect to a site that has no association with yours. And then also you might be able to see some unwanted links at the bottom of your site. And those sometimes are located within, like, the posts and pages that you have. So that, you know, you're going to want to go through some of your database entries and also look at the content of your actual pages as well. So continue on. Security is one tool that can be used to scan your site. It usually does pretty good about finding pages that have those unwanted links at the bottom, as well as you know, the attempted malware installs and things like that. So this is one tool that you can use to see that if your site's infected. They also have services to where they can help like disinfect your site. So they're a good tool that, you know, you might want to think about using. Here is some of the source code that hackers like to either put into files that exist on your site, or they'll upload just files with just this content. As you can see, there's like ways that they obfuscate a lot of the code that's in there, like by doing the string to upper, the eval, error reporting to zero, and then print out ha ha ha, and then, you know, just a way that they can make it hide what they're attempting to do in your site. So this top command right here is one command that I use in kind of doing a search of a site or a set of sites. Like right now I manage two dedicated servers with about 400 sites on it. So every now and then I log in as the root and I'll do this find command and I'll export it to the hacklog.txt file. And by doing that, I will get a lot of false positives, but I'd rather be checking every false positive to make sure I catch all the possible eval codes that are in there. And as you can see, the sample results that I show right here are showing, like, this one right here might look like it looks like a valid one. This one looks like a valid one, but when you get down to around here, this is kind of what I look for when going through this text document and trying to find what is being passed to it and being run. This is another one. This is saying that the params code is about being evaluated. So once again, that tells that somebody can pass a parameter to this part of the website and then be able to run whatever they want. And that's definitely something that you don't want to have do. The base64 decode, that just decodes what they're putting through, which is usually PHP code, and then it's being evaluated right here. And this is just a straight, whatever's being passed through a post variable, which is like, basic forms and stuff like that, that's being evaluated in this instance. One thing that I actually found within the last couple weeks is Look-See Security Scanner. It's a plugin that pretty much does what that find command does in the Linux shell. So it'll scan all the core files, all the plugins, and it even finds hidden directories too. And it allows you to kind of look at suspicious files or missing files or files that don't belong there, and really kind of analyze what is being done maliciously within your site. In this instance, I did a scan of all the core files, I believe, and I had it analyze the content, and it didn't find any files that were suspicious out of 1,020 that it did scan. There is a FAQ page on the WordPress.org site that does a pretty good job about talking about a lot of these key points. Checking with your hosting service provider, seeing if it's just a service outage or if it is truly a site hack. Create a backup of what you do have, so in the beginning point to work from. So even though it is a backup of a hacked site, you still have that point to go back to. You never know how often when you're deleting a file and it turns out that it was just a line of code in that file that you needed to delete. So by having that backup, you have that point to be able to go back to. Improving your access control by password updating and also cookie resetting. And WordPress talks about how to do that by updating the salt keys within your WP config file. By updating those salt keys, it invalidates any cookies that are out there on, that may be stored on somebody's computer, giving them access to that file or to that account. And then doing a scan of your database through phpMyAdmin to see if you have any malicious code is another one of their suggestions. Here is a sample of one thing that you can run within phpMyAdmin to try to see if you have any code on posts or pages that are malicious or trying to include content. The iframed in of a JavaScript code trying to pull in another site or trying to get you to download a malicious file. No script, forcing, saying if there's no JavaScript enabled on your browser to, display this. And the display none is also used often in trying to hide images and stuff like that can be malicious on your site. Sometimes I've even done, you know, basic scans within within that search bar on the top right of in the back end of WordPress for, you know, a prescription name to see, you know, where it is, because I know that that prescription name is located somewhere within the site. And it's helped me find the code that I need to then worry about deleting. So, initial steps to take when doing a recovery. The first thing that I usually like to do is I like to delete almost all of the files on the site with what come within the zip file of what you download from WordPress. So I try to find the same version that you're currently running. I delete the WP admin directory, the WP includes directory, and almost all the files in the root file except for the WP config file. By doing that, it makes sure that no files within WP admin or WP includes I find it when sometimes hackers will put files that look legit in those subdirectories. So by deleting those directories in its entirety, you're able to start from scratch. And any real developer should never be putting any customized code in any of those directories or files. They should always be doing it within the WP content folder, working within their plugins or their themes or, you know, whatever they're developing with. So now this is when I usually go through and I'll check you know, existing files in that that text log that I have. And this is a sample of one of the files. It's saying, you know, if a post SC is set, then and SC equals that substring. So if the person that's doing the hacking is passing the proper SC variable to it, then, you know, echo the contents of the WP content folder, and allowing them to kind of see what's in your system and then be able to find other vulnerabilities that they might not be able to see otherwise. So that's one sample. By the way, I'll have these slides up and available, you know, for you to go over at another time. So I know I'm kind of going through them kind of quickly. So this is another standalone file that they put into the 2012 theme directory, and they named it so that it looked legit. But as you can see towards the bottom of it, they, you know, they're blocking the errors from being displayed, and then trying to do this lovely eval code of something that I have no idea of what it's trying to say. But I know that if they're trying to obfuscate this much code, they're definitely not doing something that's good. So another thing to look at too is the dates of the files that are in the folders too, because sometimes they don't have the means to modify those date files to be older dates. So you can kind of see, you know, something's been updated within the last day or two. That file might be a good one to examine and look at and try to clean. So here's another couple of examples. The top one was a standalone one that I found, and the next one was one that just had a basic line of code put in at the top of the file. So in the, you know, in that first file's instance, I just deleted it, but in the comments.php file, I just, you know, deleted that line of code. Or sometimes I just comment them out so that I can, you know, see them later on in time. So here's a decoded sample of that example that I just had. It, as you can see, it decodes it and says if the password matches what, you know, the hacker has already predetermined, then run whatever's in the code post variable. Pretty much allowing them to execute almost any code on your website, allowing them to upload a script that then gives them ability to change any PHP settings or upload any files or modify any files. I remember about a few years back when I first started learning about the hacking, I found this one file that pretty much gave in one box a directory listing, in another box change permissions ability, insert malicious code into all files in a subdirectory, and it was really a malicious way to do it. And I mostly call these people script kiddies, because the people that write these scripts aren't the ones that are doing the hacking. They don't want to get caught. They want to give another like a subordinate the ability to hack into your website and allow them to do something malicious on you know to your site. And it is kind of frustrating, and it definitely is frustrating. So sometimes you run into issues where it's sometimes the hosting provider's fault because they're not keeping up to date with their server, making sure that Apache is all updated or patched up, outdated SSLs or outdated SSL server, you know. But a lot of times once they become aware of those patches, they do resolve them, but that can make it so that not only your account, but everyone's account on that server can be vulnerable. There's plenty of hosting providers out there that can help protect you from hackers, you know, like WordPress VIP Hosting, WP Engine, Flywheel, Pressable, and Media Temple are just a handful of ones that offer managed WordPress hosting, and they do a lot to help protect you and sometimes even speed up your site by offering special services like caching and stuff like that. One thing that definitely you want to do is create backups of your site often, because you never know when your site's going to get hacked. Managed WP is one service that's out there that allows you to manage multiple web hosting accounts or WordPress web hosting servers under one dashboard. But they also offer backups to not only locally but also to an off-site location. VaultPress is another one that offers you the daily backups. They allow up to 30 days archive. There's also plenty of other plugins out there that allow you to upgrade or to back up, like Backup Buddy, BackWP Up. I've used Dropbox Backup and Restore because it allows that offsite backup, and, you know, not giving somebody the ability to download one file of all of your site with your database. cPanel also has the ability to do an export of all your files and databases in one package too. So sometimes that's a good way of doing it as well. So once you have a clean site, it's always good to create a new backup so that you have that point where you can go back to if you need to. Say within the next day or so of you getting hacked, you get hacked again because you didn't close up that one vulnerability. By having that backup point, you can restore back and then try to find that vulnerability that's there, giving you that kind of fresh point again. And it also gives you that point to be able to re-examine the files that are still on your system. So if your site happens to have been hacked within Google, you would need to go into Google Webmasters Tools and request a malware review. Once you've gone through, they ask you, what have you done to repair your site? What kind of precautions have you done to stop it from the future? So, and this is where, you know, you would go in and say you've removed the script that's been emailing out to the 2,000 people that were in that list. Then next thing you probably want to do is go through and harden up your WordPress. You know, changing your default admin username, changing your password, changing the salt keys. Yep.
How do you change the login permission?
What was that?
How do you change the login URL?
There's different plugins out there that allow you to change the WordPress login URL.
I think
security.
That's yeah, like all-in-one security, I think, is one. There's a couple others that I've come across. Some don't work with WordPress multi-user, but some of them do. Changing the admin name, even though you can't necessarily change a username in the back end of WordPress, you can do that through phpMyAdmin. So that allows you to change usernames that way. Making sure you have not only tough passwords for your WordPress, but also for your FTP accounts, because if people get in through your FTP, you know, there's nothing stopping them from, you know, creating a user or modifying any files in your website that way either. Staying up to date on your WordPress updates is also a a good thing to do, because that hardens any holes that might be out there in WordPress. Once they become known, usually developers or good developers try to close those holes up as quickly as they can. Plugins like WordFence and Security are a couple plugins that that can monitor your site. I know that WordFence has a pro version that will actively scan not only the back end of your site, but also the front end of your site. The free version of WordFence does allow you to monitor modifications to plugins and themes that are in the repository, and that allows you to scan through the control panel in the back end. Doing periodic scans of your account is also a good idea. Doing that Linux command that was in a previous slide that searches for that eval code. There's also a few other search commands on my website that I use. Sometimes I'll just do a search for base64 encode or decode, because that's what a lot of times that I find these hackers will tend to do is use that. And don't just trust one single piece of software. I mean, WordFence is good and all, but it's not going to catch all, just like any antivirus software that you have out there. You know, people swear by using McAfee, but yet others swear by AVG. I like using them both, or something along those lines. One will catch one where another won't catch it, and I find that it's not good to put your eggs all in one basket. So, I know I've been kind of quick, but any questions? Yep.
This is good stuff. And one thing I'd add is HT access, which is really commonly hacked.
Yep. Well, a lot of times they'll put in some code in there that allows them to put those post variables and stuff into the processing of your website. So by making sure that that HT access file is usually either the base WordPress one, or I know like a W3 caching will modify it to allow better caching on its end. But that's another thing to watch for too. Yeah. A bunch of times in the past couple weeks, I've seen getting flooded from IP addresses in Western Europe, where they'll try to log in and then refresh to a different IP address and continue trying to hack in through the username, even though one doesn't exist by that username.
It's usually admin, and then they use the URL, and then they use user. I mean, it's like a hole you can follow it.
Right.
What they're doing, it's like.
That's why you were never supposed to use admin.
Ever.
No, right. Yeah, I learned that about 4 or 5 years ago, and that's when we started using different usernames. So.
This is a little more venting on this same subject, but you know, one of the things I found with the sites I've had that have been hacked recently is the whole user account is compromised, the password gets found. And so I looked at the tools, the plugins. What amazes me is, I do all my work in WordPress and love it. It amazes me that they still have not a great patchment system. And so, you know, I'm trying to find plugins to patch it up. And you see the latest version that came out, where, like, they finally actually built that in. So I was looking at it, and like, this is great. It shows like 4 strong passwords. And then I use it, and I see it has a checkbox at the bottom that says, you know, you agree to or allow a weak password.
Yeah.
But I still think, okay, well, why do you do that? Why are we not, like, getting past that?
Yeah, well, some people are still stubborn to the point where they want to use a password that they remember instead of making sure their website is as secure as possible. There's a lot of times where I've, you know, been talking to a client and their email account is actually what caused us to get blacklisted in a spam filtering system. And their password was their first name. And it's like, you really got to make sure that you're protected if you want to have that good face of your company showing. A little bit. I mean, was that about three weeks ago?
Yeah,
I know that they put out an update fairly quickly with it, but a lot of people, like I said, don't stay up to date with their updates and will get hit with it. You know, it's tough managing, 400 websites to the point where a lot of them think that it's a website is set it and forget it, and it really is not. It's a child. You gotta watch it on occasion.
But the updates are relentless on WordPress. Relentless. I to the point of calling it pain where not software anymore. It really is relentless. It's every day.
And a lot of times the developers, they'll use functions, and as new PHP versions come out, those functions become depreciated, and then all of a sudden it breaks, and then why is my site not working? And it's like just like any other piece of software that's out there, it really does need to be updated. Yeah, I actually use Managed WP. Even though it's a pay service, I don't have to worry about updating it or anything like that, but it allows me to have that ability to look at 200-plus websites in one control panel.
But emails, you don't have to.
Well, I thank you guys for sitting through my first WordPress talk. I know I was a little nervous.